This is Al Takatsch with Jefferson ClockWorks, and next on the bench is one of the most majestic mantle clocks that you'll ever come across. Majestic meaning it sounds absolutely gorgeous. There are not many of them around, and the movement is extraordinary the way it was designed. It's completely different than most of the movements out there, especially when you come to the autocorrect of the chiming mechanism. And also, because the movement is so different, you'll also see the winding arbors are not positioned at an extreme triangle like most of them are.
These dials are silver dials, very old, and the silver tarnishes and gets that patina on there. Don't think that you can clean it off. It has to be re-silvered or left alone. Don't try to clean it. You'll just make it much, much worse. It has a beautiful case, very heavy duty. I would say at least one third larger or more than most mantle clocks. It just was designed with a lot of care involved. The manufacturer being German. Wanted to make a statement. This is a high-end clock. It's a beautiful clock. You should feel very fortunate if you ever come across one of these guys. But they also have to be treated with an equal amount of respect. This has, this is the Westminster chime pinwheel, instead of having the common type that you're used to seeing.
The back of the Junghans movement that you've already seen. It's a very heavy-duty movement, typical German precision. Well, Junghans went out of their way to make this one a little bit different than anything else on the market, which is a trademark of Junghans. I'll first explain how it's supposed to work, and then I'll show you how the autocorrect works. The final timing that we need to analyze before we take it apart will be the timing of the Westminster chime barrel. And right now I have the unit sitting at the home position on the front, and you see this little arrow over right over here. This arrow is pointing straight down or right along the edge of this piece of brass right here, and that's pretty much all that we need to know as far as timing goes, because it needs to be tweaked and made perfect later. But this gets into the ballpark at the beginning of the Westminster 4 note.
Before we start taking things apart, always check to see that everything is let down. All of the main spring power needs to be gone. All of the barrels need to be shaking. See that shake? We gotta have that in all the barrels. And now we'll check the time. Okay, absolutely no power is left. Now we can go ahead and work with the back. When you're looking at the barrels, which there are three, always take a good look at it before you take it apart. Make sure that the little catch for the spring is not fractured or broken. This one looks like it's in good shape. It's too bad that there are so many super heavy-duty scratches in there. I have no idea why someone thought that that was important to do. Most probably, they figured if they stuck a screwdriver in somewhere and twisted it, that it would actually help something. And all that they were doing was limiting the life of it. Well, we want to take the spring out of here. The first thing we need to do is take the cap off. The worst thing you could ever do is to stick a screwdriver through that little square there and then torque it up, because you damage the end of the barrel and you also damage the cap, and you might fracture the spring. These little holes are put there so this little cap can go back on. It can flex and go on without much trouble. So don't think that those are access flats there. All we need to do is to pop this guy up. To do that, you simply turn it over and it's out. That's exactly how you do it the correct way.
This is the Ollie Baker type spring winder. I believe that Merits and Time Saver still sells it. It's a heavy duty unit. It comes working right out of the box. It's got a nice little ratchet that you can flip its direction. And it utilizes these double-sided winding arbors that you get when you buy the letdown kit that simply pops it right in there. So it's one purpose fits all. And what you do is you take your barrel and you find a winding adapter that fits it properly. Put it inside there. Put the barrel in there. Move the tail stock up, which locks the unit in there so it's not going to jump out at you. And you look at the way the spring winds. Make sure you wear gloves and eye protection.
Okay, we're going to take out the time side and put in the chime side next. I'll take the nuts off. When you tighten up the nuts for these tests, don't bear down on them. They only got so many times that you can bear down on them. So you don't want to waste that amount of times by when you're doing this checking routine. As long as they're tight enough where the plates are being held together, you don't have to bear down on them. Okay. Okay, now we're going to do the chime side. Let's see if we can get it together without messing. Okay, that one together. Next one. And that particular escape wheel runs in a ruby. You'll almost never come across movements that have rubies in them. So make sure that you don't put any kind of metal inside there. Do an inspection to the particular ruby. Let me see how close I can get you to it. Camera's having a little bit of trouble getting there. Okay, you can see the ruby inside there, and you see the pivot hole. There's no obvious cracks to it. It looks like a round hole. Maybe a little bit of discoloration there on one side at the 5 o'clock position. So we're going to clean that up with some isopropyl alcohol and a toothpick. And just be nice and easy when you go in there to clean that. Here's the other side. That looks pretty good there. No obvious cracks anywhere. And we'll go ahead and clean her up now. Doesn't take much when you clean them. You don't want to press like you're doing a brass bushing, because if these rubies are very, very hard, which makes them very, very brittle. Toothpick is coming out nice and clean. That's a very good sign, because if it came out dirty, that would mean the pivot was wearing. Let's go ahead and bring it back down to magnification here so we can kind of see if there's any difference in what we did here. That's not working. How about now? Okay, that little discoloration at the 5 o'clock position is gone now, so that was just a little bit of dirt. This side's looking good. That side's looking good too. Okay, time to put it
in position.
I'm going to be showing you a back view of the movement when it's going through the chiming cycle and also the strike cycle. And then once I show you that, I'll show you how to do all the adjustments up in the front in case you need some adjustments. The first thing I'm going to do is just activate the... This is the strike. See, it lifts only three of the hammers.
Each hammer has to hit the center of each one of its associated rods. If you want it a little bit louder, you would have it get a little bit closer. If it buzzes, then you want to adjust it upwards. The best kind of tool for doing that is you just take an ordinary screwdriver, like what you get from Craftsman. This is like a quarter inch flat blade. And you put a little slot in the front with a grinding disc, the Dremel, and you can simply grab a hold of each one of the rods and bend it one way or the other way so it's just right until you get this sound. Just like that. And you hear a nice melody coming from it, no buzzing, and each one of them has the same volume or amplitude. The striking assembly kind of lifts it up crooked, but I think they did that for a reason. They wanted to hit this rod harder, that's why they lift it up longer, at longer distance. And make sure that chime block is tightened down before you start adjusting these things, because there will always be very slight differences going into chiming or striking. There is a bushing on the inside of the minute hand that you can put in a tool. I purchased this one over at Merritt's. It is an awl. It's a four-sided awl. It's a wonderful little tool because you can put this into the square of the hand and hold it still, and you can actually rotate the hand around the awl, so you can move the bushing of the minute hand so it will match up with it. It's kind of a finicky adjustment. The final adjustment is when it actually moves the hand itself to the 12 o'clock. If you're just moving it with your finger, that doesn't count because you could be one or two or even 3 minutes off that way. So always let the unit do the chiming itself before you trust your particular adjustment. And so here we have a nice old Junghans. It was kind of futzed with for many, many years by other people, and now it is working beautifully. So we have another clock brought back to life. This is Al Takatsch at Jefferson ClockWorks, and we'll see you at the next clock.